You've always said, even though you were supportive of Brexit, you're one of the folks who's always said that it's important to have a very robust relationship and a defense relationship with Europe, that NATO remains core to that, but Europe the Cabinet Office has put on a new statement about the indivisible nature of Europe to the importance of British defense. Post-Brexit, what is the kind of relationship you want to have with the European Union, with the EDA, and would you entertain, for example, Britain joining the Franco-German combat aircraft program?
Well, on the first, we're leaving the European Union, but we're not leaving Europe. This is still our continent, and the security of our continent matters to us. It involves us. It involved us tragically in two world wars. So we have every interest in continuing to work for the security and help face the challenges that Europe faces. And we've laid out this week the new security partnership that we seek with Europe so that we fight terrorism together. We face the challenge of mass migration together. And yes, where there are European missions that we can contribute to, where it is in the British interest to do so, we will do that as well. And we will also want to maintain the work that our own defense companies do on collaborative programs. Typhoon aircraft was a European program, and that's the way the world is. We want to see more of those in future, and we have a very, very strong part to play in aerospace and work with the French on the next generation of fighter aircraft.
So you could see yourself, you could see Britain participating in that Franco-German effort at some point?
Well, at the moment, we're working with the French
right.
under the Lancaster House Agreement on the future combat air system. So it's too early. I think we've only just seen a sketch of the kind of ambition that the Franco-German project has. But we are very clear here, and our companies are very clear that we want to be part of future programs on this kind of scale.
And let me ask you one last question, and that's about the national shipbuilding strategy. A decade or more ago, the government put pressure on the shipyards to consolidate. You now want to see more competition out there to drive costs lower. The Type 31 program, as you said, cost capped in order to be able to drive maximum capability, but at an affordable value worldwide, but also for the Royal Navy. But there are those who say that, if Royal Navy is going to get five of those ships, that's not enough work for any of these shipyards to survive. And then the other question is, in the block building block approach for the carriers, that none of the yards has that capability. Are you concerned that given the small nature of this contract and that many people who buy the 31 would want to build it themselves, there's not enough work for the British shipbuilding industry, especially if you go to a competitive model?
Well, first of all, although I'm a believer in competition, this wasn't just my idea. We asked Sir John Parker, who knows more about British shipbuilding than anybody else from his time at Arlington Wolfe, we asked him to review warship building, and he picked up on the renaissance that's already taking place in British shipyards, yards like Camelhead and Appledore and AMP on the Tyne. So it's right to throw this open to competition and to involve as many yards as possible. Now, the initial order, of course, will be for five frigates, but if industry can meet the challenge and bring this frigate in under the $250 million price cap that I've set, that will enable us to consider future expanding the fleet in future, and it will, of course, bring costs down and in turn make it easier to export this frigate around the world. Now, you asked about block build. I'm not ruling that out as a solution. Mm-hmm. I'm not prescribing what the answer is for these five frigates. The frigate could be built in an individual yard, could be built by a consortium of yards, could be built by an international consortium, built in the UK, but involving an international consortium, or it could involve some of the block build technique and expertise that was established during the construction of the two carriers.
Let me ask one last question. The money, from a money standpoint, why is it people are using such large numbers? What is the right number in terms of bridging? People are using 30 billion, 40 billion, and you've rejected all of those numbers. Is the actual challenge you're facing a far smaller one than people think?
Look, it's a huge program of reinvestment in our armed forces. It stretches over the next 10 years. It totals over £170 billion sterling. The defence review we carried out 2 years ago has always made it clear that part of that £178 billion has to come from modernisation and efficiency savings. And so that challenge was set us right at the beginning, and I'm determined to meet it.
Sir, thanks so much, as always.